guys for coming out to take a chance to learn a little bit more about your GoPro. We've got a lot of great information here for you today, so whether you're a brand new user or have been using your GoPro for years now, you're sure to get something out of this this training. So my name is Nick Berger. I'm a training specialist with GoPro. So essentially what I do is travel around events like these and working with our retail partners and just ensure that everyone's educated on the product. You know, obviously with GoPro, it can be a fairly complicated product if you look into all the different features of bells and whistles. So we want to, you know, give you the tools to kind of simplify that so that you have a great understanding of what it is that you have in your hand, what it's capable of, and how you can really use that to get the most out of your GoPro experience. So before we jump into that, I want to start out with a video. This video is from a little over a year ago, I think. I think we posted it just after EAA last year. With one of our aviation athletes.
After my training career for the Berger pilot, it's where I found my passion for the flying sports that gave me the possibility to explore and see further and go now. Feel that if my life makes sense, so I have to be with me, but to find it out, I have to go back to my roots. This is like being out there.
Mix of cameras. Anybody out there with older models like the GoPro us when you were three. Okay, looks like a lot of you guys have both older and newer models, so that's great. So you should have a pretty good baseline for what we're talking about. Those of you that are working off older models, there will be a lot of crossover in the things that I talk about today. So I'll be sure to point out which things that I mentioned that are specific to the Hero 4 and some of our newer models, whereas the rest of it will be pretty much applicable across all of our models. So starting with our Hero session, this camera is our smallest and lightest camera that we've ever released at GoPro. It's actually our first camera that's completely waterproof without any kind of housing. So just like that, this little cube is capable of going down to 10 meters underwater and getting some amazing results with that underwater footage. Because it is also our first camera without any kind of external housing that it goes in, we also had to take a different look at the way this camera records audio. Because you don't have a housing there to protect, you know, in high wind situations and things like that. So what we did with this model is we created a dual microphone system. And the camera is capable, it's got a mic on the front as well as the back of the camera, and it's capable of dynamically switching between those two mics to help ensure that you're getting the cleanest, you know, best audio that you have available at the time. So some really cool stuff there. One of the big features of the Hero Session is the easy one-button control. So unlike with some of our other models, this camera doesn't have a separate power button. All you have to do is press that shutter button on the top of the camera one time, it's gonna power itself up and go straight into recording for you. So really nice, easy way to ensure that you're not gonna miss that shot. Now, if you prefer photos to video, what you have the ability to do is just press and hold that button for about 5 seconds. Once you press and hold it, it's gonna power up and go straight into shooting a time-lapse photo sequence. So you have either photos or video really quickly and easily at your fingertips there. In terms of performance, this camera shoots at 1440p at 30 frames per second, 1080p at 60, and 720p at 100 frames per second. So some really great options for HD video for you. All right, moving on from that, I will talk about our Hero 4 Silver. This is our most popular, best-selling option out there, and a large part of the reason for that, and those of you that have the Silver will understand, is that easy touch screen built into the back of the camera. So with that screen, it ultimately creates a menu that's much more similar to what we're used to seeing on our smartphones and tablets and all those kind of devices. Overall, it becomes a much more intuitive process when it comes to actually setting up your camera. Whereas the smaller display on the front has some great info there, but it's a little bit tougher. It takes a certain element of decoding to kind of work with that quite easily. So the screen on the back goes a long way with Silver. In addition to that ability to set up your camera through that touch screen, you can of course use it to frame up your shots, review photos and videos that you've already taken, as well as some other key features like trimming your videos, which I'll talk about in a little bit. In terms of performance, this camera's got some really great features available. And what I'm going to do is I'm actually going to switch over to the Black Edition here to compare the two when it comes to performance. So when we talk about our Black Edition, that is our professional level top of the line model. Shoots all the way up to 4K video, so you can get those really amazing professional results. It'll also do 2.7K at 60 frames per second, 1080 at 120, as well as 720 at 240 frames per second. So for those of you that are looking to do some of that amazing slow-mo footage out there, this camera's got the frame rates that really allow you to capture all that great action. Now when you look at the comparison to the Hero 4 Silver, you do have all those same resolution options available. However, you're typically going to take that frame rate that I mentioned and cut that in half, and that's what you have for the Silver. So ultimately, especially for those of you that maybe have the older models, when you compare the Silver and Black, when we look at the Hero 4, it's a much smaller gap in performance than we're used to seeing from the past compared to the Silver and the Black, which is another reason that really contributes to that Silver being that top selling item. And then the Hero 4 Black and Silver also, both of those cameras have like an amazing 12 megapixel still photos. You can take a burst rate of up to 30 photos in 1 second. We'll talk a bit more about our burst photos. And a ton of other cool features that we'll go into in a little bit as we kind of get into this presentation. So let's talk about the basics. Again, we're going to take this from the perspective of this is your first time taking a camera out of the box. What does everything do? And this will go fairly quick, so those of you that do already know the basics, don't worry, we won't spend too much time on it, but want to make sure that we have a good baseline for where everyone is. So we're starting with the Hero 4 cameras. These cameras are essentially designed the same. same, with that one exception being the screen on the back. So what we have here, we have a handful of different bugs. So I'm just going to take one at a time. Excuse me, I'm going to grab my laser pointer here. Same one that you see right up the camera's mount on right out of the box. And then the other one is a J-hook buckle. It's a little swoop there. And that's going to be designed for mounting to vertical surfaces. If I want to mount my camera to a wall or to my chest, I need that little loop to allow it to still be oriented forward rather than pointed at the ground. And next we have our camera menu for the Hero 4 options. You guys may remember back when I was talking about our little settings and tag button on the side of the camera, that when you press that, it's going to pull up your settings menu. Now the key thing to note with the Hero 4 models is that we really redesigned the way our menu operates. And what I mean by that is we've taken what used to be just essentially one big bucket of all your different settings options, and we've categorized them based on what mode you're shooting in. So if my camera is set to video, and I press that side button, it's going to pull up a menu that's specific to my video options. Whereas if I'm in photo, I press the side button, it'll pull up a menu specific to my photo options. What this ultimately means for you as a user is compared to past models, when you need to go in and change quick settings like your resolution or your frame rate, it takes less than half as many pushes of the actual buttons on the camera to get to the same spot that you would have on a past model. So it really streamlines the actual operation side of things. So let's jump into the actual menu itself and what are some of the different options that you'll see when you're scrolling through that menu. We're going to start with video. Video is going to be that default power on mode for all of our cameras. And we have several different sort of subcategories within the video world there. We have our standard video, just your point and shoot. It's what most of us are using most of the time. We have a video and photo option. The video and photo gives you the ability to take video at 1080p, as well as take 12 megapixel photos every 5 seconds during that video. So when you finish whatever it is that you were shooting, you're going to have both that video file as well as the photos available, so that you have even more options for how you can share that content. Video looping is primarily used for surveillance and liability type purposes. It allows the card to record until the card is full, and then it'll just loop back around on itself and record over that footage. So you get that nice buffer of space. We see a lot of people using GoPros for dash cams or motorcycles. There's people that are concerned about potential liability stuff. So it's a great way to do that without ever having to check your actual footage if you're not filming for that purpose. And then the last one is time-lapse video. Time-lapse video gives us the ability to essentially shoot a series of photos that the camera will automatically stitch together and create a nice short shareable video file. So you can capture those great progressions like the clouds moving across the sky and really cool results like that. Beyond that, we have our photo. Under photo, we have our single photo, continuous photo, and night photo. I'm going to talk about all three of those in a little bit more detail in a little bit, so I won't go into them now. On multi-shot, we have our burst, our time-lapse, and our night-lapse. And again, I'll go into those all in some more detail in a minute. Beyond that, we're going to see our playback option. Now, the playback is only going to show up on a Hero 4 Silver, or if you're using an LCD backpack, a screen attachment, for the Hero 4 Black Edition, because it has to actually have somewhere that the video can play back, or that playback option is not going to show up for you. And then lastly, we have our setup, and that's where all of our non-capture related settings are going to live. It's going to be our controls for the Wi-Fi and the indicator lights on the camera, and how loud the beeps are now that we're hearing and all that kind of stuff. All right, so that covers the basics on the Hero 4 Black and Silver Edition. Let's jump over to the Hero Session. And just talk a little bit about it. I actually mentioned most of this stuff already, so I'm going to kind of speed through this, but I do want to recap on the highlights. Waterproof, without any kind of housing, you can take it down to 10 meters or 33 feet. So really, really great camera to use for snorkeling or just kind of basic water sports. Not as ideal for scuba diving, because you want a little bit more depth out of that. It has a built-in battery. The built-in battery on this camera is going to last for about 2 hours of continuous recording time. However, the key thing to keep in mind here is that one button control on the camera ensures that anytime you're not actually recording, you have the camera powered down and in standby mode, so it's not draining the battery. What that ends up meaning is that battery tends to last a really long time when you're just using it for quick recordings. I've actually never had one of these cameras die on me during the day of shooting. Now, given I usually take 2 or 3 so it's, it may have a little bit of an advantage there, but they really do an incredible job when it comes to battery life and maintaining that side of things. the package for the Hero 7 is a bit more simplified. If anyone bought this camera back when it was called the Hero 4 Session, before the price was reduced, it did have a couple of additional items in it. But this is what we currently have today. You're getting with the camera a nice frame to allow you to use it with the different mounting options. You still get one of those curved and one of those flat adhesive mounts, and you get the quick release buckle for mounting onto that. And when it comes to the menu on the Session, it does have essentially the same setup as our Hero 4 options, with the exception being that it is slightly more limited in terms of available capture modes. So it's a more simple, you know, less different options available on the menu. For video, we have that standard video as well as video looping. For photo, we have single photo. And for multi-shot, we have burst and time-lapse. And then again, we have our setup where we can access all of our additional camera settings. With the Hero Session, it does have this just a little small display on the top of the camera. So when it comes to actually setting up the camera, I typically always recommend either connecting a Wi-Fi remote or using your GoPro app to go in and set up your settings. It's a much more easier workflow, especially even compared to the other Hero 4 models when you're doing those. Okay, so that wraps us up on the basics of the two cameras. Now, anyone that is working with older camera models, you are going to see mostly similarities to the other Hero 4 options. The Session is our first camera that has a smaller form factor, and it's changed quite a bit. If you are working with older camera models, you're going to see a lot of similarities, with the one key exception being that menu structure. When you look at your menu, you're going to see all of the different capture options available individually. You'll see video, photo, time-lapse, burst. All those different options are going to be individual capture modes on the actual camera. All right, so let's jump in and talk about key features. We've got a ton of stuff that we've built into these cameras to ultimately make it an easier and a better process for you guys to be able to use them. And let's dive into what some of those features are. Now, the first one, and I mentioned this briefly earlier, is the on-camera video trimming, is the trim and share functionality. Within the trim and share, we have two different workflows available for you. The first is doing it on camera, and the second is doing it through the GoPro app. Both of these are great ways to go in and trim down your videos and just get those nice, just those moments that you really want to capture and share out right away. It's important, though, to understand the difference between the two workflows and the benefits of using either one. So when we talk about on-camera trimming, you do need a camera that has a screen built in on the back. So the Hero 4 Silver, or you can attach an LCD backpack to your Hero 4 Black Edition. As well as if anybody out there maybe has one of the cameras that we sold last year called the Hero Plus LCD, that one will also have it available. Now when you trim on the camera, you have four different options for how you can trim your clip. You can take a 30 second, 15, 5 second segment of longer clip, or you can pull a still directly out from one of your videos. When you do this through the on-camera workflow, what it's going to do is it's going to create a brand new copy of that portion of your original clip, which will maintain the full resolution and full frame rate from your original video. So if you are wanting to use the camera just to trim up some quick clips so that when you go to drop that into your larger edit you're creating later, this is going to be the way you want to do it because it's going to maintain that full resolution and full frame rate. On the other hand, trimming through the GoPro app, which does tend to be the more popular way to do it, we see more people using the GoPro app to do their trimming overall. When you trim it through the GoPro app, it's instead going to ask you, where do you want to share this content? And you have options to select, you know, Facebook, YouTube, Instagram, or you can select just save my camera roll. And what it's going to do in that case is it's going to optimize the quality of the clip, the copy that it makes, based on where you're sharing that footage. So if you're sharing to Facebook, it's going to get you the correct resolution and bitrate that Facebook likes for you to share your videos. So it makes it a really easy process when it comes to actually sharing that content out. Next we have ProTune. And ProTune, as the name suggests, is a feature that we really developed with our professional customers in mind. Because back in 2012, we were still selling the Hero 2, and we were seeing a ton of use of that camera on shows like The Deadliest Catch and Mythbusters. And the biggest piece of feedback we got back from those production teams was that it was really, really difficult to incorporate GoPro footage with footage that they were taking on their other, you know, tens of thousands of dollar cameras. And so we took a look at and said, how can we make that process better? How can we make it so that that GoPro footage can look a little bit more professional, look a little bit more like what these guys are getting from their other cameras, and even more importantly, to give you more possibility in what you can do on the post-production side. If any of you have ever been involved in any kind of major productions, you have a pretty good understanding that there is a lot of post-production that goes into those. And ultimately, what we discovered is that the GoPro footage with the presets and compressions that existed was increasingly difficult to use in that kind of workflow and incorporate with that professional footage. So we developed this feature, ProTune, and what it does is when you turn ProTune on your camera, it will actually unlock an entirely new list of settings that you didn't previously see as available options. So the manual control, it gives you manual control of options like the color profile, white balance, ISO limit, sharpness, and exposure. And that allows you to really go in and fine tune and kind of tweak your different settings to ensure that you're getting that footage back exactly the way you want it and the way that gives you the most capability on the post-production side of things. Now that being said, for people that don't have really any post-production expertise, I typically recommend avoiding ProTune, at least until you get a little bit more experience on the editing side of things. It does require a bit more knowledge about what you're doing on the post-production side to really get the most out of that. And to be entirely honest, in most situations, those GoPro presets look phenomenal. They are really, you know, really awesome options. It just gets a little bit tricky when you're holding them, you know, side by side with a camera that costs $30,000. Okay, so beyond that, we have a highlight tag. A highlight tag is one of my favorite features. It allows for you to really streamline the playback and editing side of the GoPro experience. What that means, and you guys may recall that this little button on the side I mentioned is our settings and tag button. This is the tag portion of that. And when I'm actually recording video and I press that button, it's going to mark that moment in my footage so that when I go back to view that footage later, I first of all know which clip I marked this highlight on. And secondly, I can jump, I get a little tick mark right on my timeline so I can jump straight to that point that I've highlighted and ensure that I don't have to watch all the rest of the lead up to that moment, you know, that one moment that I really wanted to capture. And then we have our quick capture and one button control. I've already talked quite a bit about the one button control on the session. Really easy, just press that button and let it go. You do have that capability on the other Hero 4 models as well, and it's through a feature called quick capture. Key difference there is that with quick capture, you do actually have to go into your settings menu and turn it on. The icon for it looks like a little bunny rabbit, so just keep an eye out for that rabbit and turn that on, and you'll be able to operate your cameras the same way. So, let's see, I've got mine on right now, but I'll turn it off. Press the button, and then the camera, again, is going to power itself up, go straight into recording video. Just like with that one button mode, you also have the ability to press and hold the button, power up, and go into a time-lapse photo sequence. So you have a lot of capability for what you can really accomplish with your one button mode and quick capture. Okay. So now what we want to do is talk a little bit more in depth about setting up your camera to capture video. When we take a look at our Hero 4 Black Edition, what we're actually talking about is over 150 different capture modes available on that camera, which that can obviously be a fairly overwhelming number, especially for those that don't have any experience with GoPro or videography in general. So what we're going to do here is we're going to break down kind of the three key components of how you need to set up your camera for video to ensure that no matter what situation you're in, you're going to have those best settings and not miss that shot. The first thing we want to talk about is aspect ratio. And when we're talking aspect ratio, it's important firstly to understand what is aspect ratio. Second, what options do we have available? And third, what are the benefits of using those different options? So first I want to talk about our 16 by 9 aspect ratio. 16 by 9 is our standard format that we're going to be seeing on most devices. Sorry, actually, let me back up. First, I want to say, what is aspect ratio? Which is ultimately going to be the ratio between the width of your video and the height of your video. So the 16 by 9 aspect ratio is what we're used to seeing on all of our HDTVs, what we're seeing this presentation in. We'll see it on our phones and our computers and all that kind of good stuff. So that 16 by 9 aspect ratio tends to be really beneficial because without doing any kind of work with that footage on the post-production side, you can plug that into your TV or email it out to your friends to watch on their phone, and the formatting will look correct. It's got the right format already to watch on any of our places that we consume media at this point. When we talk about the 4x3 aspect ratio, that's that much more square, kind of boxy looking image, what we're used to seeing on our older style 2D. If we were to put it on an HDTV, just straight out of the camera with the HDMI cable, we would see black bars on the side of our footage because we don't have enough there to fill out that whole rectangular screen. Now the key thing though when we talk GoPro footage with 4x3 aspect ratio is that using a 4x3 aspect ratio actually utilizes a larger portion of the camera sensor vertically. So what that means is that when I shoot at a 4x3 compared to a 16x9, I actually end up with a taller frame at the end of that that shot. So anytime where I've got the camera mounted close to myself or whatever my subject may be, and I'm trying to get as much of that body in there, using that 4x3 aspect ratio is going to be hugely beneficial because it's going to give me that taller frame and allow me a lot more flexibility of what I am actually shooting. The other key thing to keep in mind with your 4x3 content is that it does actually provide you a bit more capability on the post-production side. And what I mean by that is we can take a 4x3 video and we can stretch it out to fit into that proper 16x9 format, or we can just crop it, where we essentially just drop that same 16x9 window over our original taller footage. And what that enables us to do is move the 16x9 frame up or down a little bit. So maybe the bulk of the action was happening up towards the top of my shot. I can just adjust where that, which portion of my 4x3 shot I'm looking at, and get some really great results there. Now, that does require a little bit of, work on the post-production side, and for those that maybe don't have that experience or are just not interested in getting into that side of things, we do have another option available, and it's called SuperView. Now, SuperView is really something that we designed to give you the best of both worlds when we're talking about aspect ratios. It's gonna take your video, it's gonna shoot it at that taller 4x3 frames, so you're getting the benefit of the additional height on your field of view. But then the camera itself is going to automatically take that shot, stretch it into the 16x9 format, so right out of the box you're getting the benefit of that taller frame as well as the correct formatting so you can play it back easily. Yeah?
When you stretch it, is that making
quality less? Great question. So if anyone didn't hear, he was asking if you lose quality by stretching the frame. So in this case, you're not going to be losing quality. However, you will experience some distortion. Anytime you're stretching out a frame like that, you're going to experience that, some level of distortion. What it does with SuperView, and it's true of when I was talking about 4x3 and stretching in post-production, you will experience distortion on that side of things as well. Most editing softwares that give you the capability to stretch it out like that give you also the capability to adjust where the distortion appears. And SuperView does a similar thing, but it does it automatically. It's what we call dynamically stretching the footage. So it'll take that distortion, push it to the outside edges of the frame. So your subject, which is typically going to be in the center, is going to remain, looking normal. And then out on the outside edges, you get a bit of distortion. What that ultimately means is that there are some situations where SuperView is great, and somewhere it's going to look terrible. And for the terrible option, what I'm going to say is, if I've got my camera up here, and I'll just slide it here for this purpose, but if I'm trying to pan a shot across this room of people, you're going to look on the outside of the frame, big and kind of weird and distorted than normal, in the middle of them, weird and distorted again on the outside. So it's not going to be ideal for any time where you've got that kind of lateral movement in front of the camera. But in situations where you've got the camera mounted, and your subject will typically remain in the same spot in the center of the frame, it's SuperView does a really, really great job. Once we've decided our aspect ratio, the next question we're going to ask ourselves is, what resolution are we going to use to shoot this video? So it's important to understand that aspect ratio and resolution really go hand in hand. This little chart that I have up here, which is nearly impossible to see on this screen, so apologies there, but this chart is actually a depiction of the camera sensor and what portion of that sensor is utilized by shooting in different resolution options. We do have this available on our website if anyone is interested in more detail on how that works. But what you'll notice with this chart is that some of the options we have there are squares and some of them are rectangular. Aspect ratio, when you're choosing your aspect ratio, you're not actually going to go in and find an option in your settings that says aspect ratio. Rather, the aspect ratio you choose is going to be tied to a specific resolution. So for example, when I'm talking about my 4x3 options, I have 960p, 1440p, and 2.7K as a 4x3 option. All of the other resolution options are going to be that 16x9 format. So we always recommend first deciding on which resolution you want to use, and from there, first deciding which aspect ratio you want to use, and from there, determining a resolution that's going to fit within that aspect ratio need, and also accomplish your goals in terms of quality. And so what we ask ourselves at this point is, how am I ultimately going to view or share this content that I'm shooting right now? And that answer will really quickly and easily help you determine what resolution is going to be the best. If the answer is I want to, you know, pull a 15-second clip to put on an Instagram page, or I want to, you know, maybe throw something on YouTube and email it to my mom, typically, I'm not going to go with that high of a resolution option, particularly with Instagram, because you're getting back such a low resolution in the end, looking at it on your phone, that nobody's ever going to notice that difference in quality. However, if I'm on the other side of that coin, and I'm a member of the GoPro media team, and I'm out shooting with the highest possible quality as my number one goal, that's going to be the situation where I'm going to try to get it up as high as possible. For our media team, just for your guys' knowledge, they typically don't shoot anything below 1440p. 1440p, they use that when they're looking to get that 4x3 aspect ratio, but with a frame rate that's high enough for them to be able to slow down that footage. Anything below that, our media team kind of just avoids in general. Me personally, I don't use anything above 1440p because I'm never really shooting for that kind of quality. I don't have that much time to put into my edits, and the higher the resolution option I choose, the longer it's going to take me to download the footage, to edit it, to export my edit, and ultimately to upload it somewhere to share. So we always try to say, make it as choose an option that accomplishes your goals, but make it as easy as possible on yourself when you're deciding resolution.
Are those all the same field of view?
Great question. Are they all the same field of view? So they are in the standard option, all the same field of view. You do have in your 16x9 resolutions, 1080p is a great example. You have the ability to actually adjust the field of view. So you can change it from a wide to a medium to a narrow field of view. And what that will do is actually by adjusting the field of view, and thank you for asking, that's a great question, because I get this question quite often is, does GoPro have anything to zoom, or how can I kind of bring the action closer to the front? And by adjusting your field of view from going from a wide angle to a medium down to a narrow, will actually give the appearance of bringing those items that are farther away closer to the camera. But yeah, the standard will have the same field of view horizontally. So it's not actually zooming. When you adjust that field of view, it's a similar effect, but it works differently than a digital zoom, for example, on your phone. What it does is it actually crops in on the camera sensor, so it will still maintain the full resolution that you're shooting when you adjust that field of view. Now, I should say, if you look at the footage from both of them side by side, you can sometimes see a bit of a difference in terms of quality between the two, but the actual resolution, when you drop that into an editing system, you will see that full resolution that you originally started with. Okay, so once we've decided what our aspect ratio we want to shoot in, what resolution we want to use, the last question we're going to ask ourselves is what frame rate. And can anyone out there tell me the benefit of shooting at a high frame rate? The key benefit? Yeah.
Slow-mo.
That's probably the number one thing that shooting at a high frame rate is going to get you, is the ability to take that high frame rate, slow it down to a standard 30 frames per second, and maintain that incredibly smooth slow motion. It also tends to be a good option for your really fast action shots. Anything that's kind of high movement, high vibration type activities, tend to be better with a high frame rate. However, the key thing to keep in mind when we're talking about a high frame rate is that you actually need to have really good lighting conditions to ensure that your image quality is going to maintain the standard that you're used to seeing from your GoPro when you're shooting at high frames. So we use 120 frames per second right now as our example for a high frame rate. It's available on the black edition in 1080p or on the silver edition at 720p. When we're talking about 120 frames per second, what that ultimately means is that my shutter on my camera is opening and closing 120 times in that single second, which is obviously incredibly fast, and it just doesn't give as much time for light to be able to get in there and reach the sensor between it opening and closing so quickly. So when you're shooting in darker or lower light scenarios, we always recommend going with a lower frame rate. You are going to sacrifice that ability to slow down the footage and maintain that smooth motion, but you're going to gain a lot on the actual image quality side of things. And you know, overall, we feel that that having a bad-looking image in slow motion is not as good as having a good-looking one in regular motion. So, and similar to SuperView, we've kind of created our own best of both worlds option when it comes to framing, and that's called auto low light. Now, auto low light, the first thing I want to say about auto low light is that this little video that I have playing where they're in concert and there's strobe lights and things like that is not going to be the spot where auto low light is actually going to be the most ideal. And it's been a little battle of having my creative team to get me a new video over here. Where it will work really well is going from, let's say I've got my camera mounted on my car and I'm going for a nice bright sunny day and I drive into a tunnel. You know, that drastic change in my lighting conditions, the camera's going to recognize it. And what it will do is it will take that frame rate that I've set and reduce frames off of it so that you ensure that your image quality is not going to suffer based on the changing darkening lighting conditions. You do need to start at a minimum of 48 frames per second as your kind of baseline, so that it has the ability to reduce frames and still stay above 30 frames. As we get down there, as really what it is, as we get below 24 frames per second, is below the rate that our eye will actually perceive a video. So it'll essentially just look like a series of photos almost, or a really jerky video. One thing that I want to mention with both auto low light and SuperView is that both of these modes are not something that we see typically used by professionals. With the one exception being that we at GoPro use SuperView a lot in our live broadcast type applications, because it allows you to get that taller frame in a live scenario without any post-production work. But generally, auto low light and SuperView are not something you see used by professionals. And the reason for that is that they do kind of take a level of control away from you. Now, they do that by making these other questions kind of much easier for you. So we do still see a lot of value in them and a lot of popularity. But it's just something that I do like to mention. Okay. Now we'll talk about our video modes. Let's jump into photo modes really quick, and then we are going to talk a bit about the software options, and we'll wrap it up. So, on the photo side of things, I think that photo modes can a lot of times get overshadowed by the amazing video that these cameras can capture. But there's some really awesome photos. Like I mentioned, 12 megapixel stills on the Hero 4 black and silver, 8 megapixel stills on the Hero 4 session. Capability in terms of capturing great photos. Let's take a look at some of the different photo modes that are available on the camera. I skipped over our single photo. I do want to make sure you guys all know it's available. You can just set it to single and press the button one time to get one photo out of the end. I don't typically recommend using it because there's so many other great capture options that can be used in place of that single photo. One of them is our continuous photo option. And continuous photo can be great for capturing that kind of key moment. And what it's going to do is it's going to allow the camera to capture a sequence of 3, 5, or 10 photos per second as long as you continue holding that shutter button down. So you just press and hold that button, it's just going to rapid fire your shots off to ensure that you're not going to miss that key moment. The best example I always like to give here is, you know, you're at the finish line of a race and a family member is about to cross that finish line, you're really excited and exhausted and you're trying to capture that moment. You can just press that button, hold it down, and ensure that when that happens, you're capturing the shot. Now, one thing I want to mention here is that it will max you out at a total of 30 photos, and then the camera needs a second to kind of take a breath and record those on the card. So if you're shooting at 10 photos per second, you do have 3 seconds worth of time holding it down. If you're shooting at 3 photos per second, you've got 10 seconds to hold it down. Next, we have our burst photo. And burst is similar to our continuous photo in that it's going to allow us to capture that kind of sequence of photos. The key differences when we're talking burst compared to continuous is that one, you just need to press the button one time, you don't need to keep holding it down. And two, burst is your fastest photo capture mode available, going all the way up to 30 photos in 1 second. Which, to be honest, 30 photos in 1 second is a little bit too fast for most things that you're trying to capture. One thing that I always have fun doing with that 30 in 1 second is that if you take a water balloon, fill up the water balloon, and then just take that burst photo of you popping it with a pin, and you can capture that great moment where the water bubble is kind of just suspended in the air and the balloon is already flown away. So some cool stuff that you can do with your burst photo. The most popular option for burst photo is 30 photos in 3 seconds. With the Hero 4 Black and Silver, you can also bump that all the way up to 30 photos over 6 seconds. So you can get a lot of different ranges in terms of how you can capture those bursts. And you can use them to capture that sequence of events and then pulling out just a single photo, the best photo from the mix. We like to do that pretty regularly. Or you can even go into Photoshop and stitch together the entire sequence of events to capture those really cool kind of progression shots. Now that is a little bit more complex and requires some Photoshop knowledge, but we'll get you some really awesome results. Next we have time-lapse. And time-lapse is probably the most popular photo option on our cameras. You've heard me mention it a few times today when I'm talking about one-button mode and quick capture, but time-lapse is an amazing feature that's going to allow you to set an interval and your camera will just continually take photos at whatever interval you set until you cut it off. You can use that, of course, to create these really awesome time-lapse videos. GoPro Studio as well as the GoPro app for desktop, which we'll talk about in a little bit here, are really easy tools to stitch your photos, your time-lapse sequences together into a video. But time-lapse is also a great feature that you can use when you just want to mount the camera and you won't have the ability to press the button to trigger your photos. Just mount it, set up your time-lapse, let it run, and you're going to end up with thousands of photos at the end of your action. But you're guaranteed to get one or two that are winners. I often use my time lapse for that purpose, especially when I'm doing some kind of activity that maybe I'm not very skilled at, and I don't want anyone to see the video of how much of a fool I look like out there. I recently went down to a mountain biking for the first time, and I had my camera running time lapse all day, and ended up with a couple of photos that actually made it look like I knew what I was doing. And then our night photo and night lapse. So our night photo and night lapse really mirror our single photo and our time lapse. With the big difference being that you have the ability now with your GoPro to actually shoot with an extended shutter speed. So you're capable of having the shutter on your camera open and absorbing light for up to a full 30 seconds. Gives you the ability to capture these really cool kind of events. What you're seeing on this time-lapse here is a lightning storm. It also gives you the ability to capture shots of the stars moving across the night sky. A ton of really cool results with our night photo and night lapse. So there's two different workflows when it comes to our night photo and night lapse. The first is using an automatic exposure of up to 2 seconds. And the key phrase that I just used there is the up to 2 seconds. So we talk about, so the up to 2 seconds, what that means is that the camera is actually going to read the lighting conditions that it's in. And once it is determined that it's received enough light to take a good photo, that's going to be the point where it actually snaps that photo. So it is capable of going from a fraction of a second up to 2 seconds with this automatic exposure range. One really cool way that you can use that, and GoPro is actually at the moment the only camera out there that is capable of doing this, is you can set up your camera to capture an event like a sunset or a sunrise. Use that automatic mode, and you're getting, when the sun is still out and it's a nice bright day, you're getting a photo that exposes in a fraction of a second, and as it gets darker and darker, that exposure time gets longer and longer, up to 2 seconds, allowing you to capture the full progression of day to night, or night to day, without changing a single setting on your actual camera. So some really fun results that you can get with that. The other workflow is going to be using a fixed exposure, where you can set that exposure to be either 2, 5, 10, 15, 20, or 30 seconds. A lot of different options depending on what the conditions are you're shooting in. Typically, I recommend for man-made type lights, 2, 5, or 10 seconds as the key options. For example, I'm going to be at the night show tonight, and I'm going to be shooting a bunch of night photos of the fireworks and different stuff that they have going on here. For those types of shots, I'm definitely not going to be going over 10 seconds, but most likely I'll be around 10 seconds for most of those photos that I take. The higher options, like 15, 20, or 30 seconds, are going to be your great options for when you are out in the middle of nowhere and you just have very little light, or the shots, like I mentioned, of getting shots of the stars and the sky at night. Those are going to be the ones where you want that highest possible exposure time. Okay, now we've talked a lot about videos, photos, all that good stuff. Let's talk about how you can take that content that you've shot, get it off your camera, and share it out to the world. So first thing I want to talk about is the GoPro app for desktop. And this is a fairly new feature that we've actually released. But it's definitely one of my favorite software options we have available. What it does, and it essentially is not designed as an editing software, rather as a way for you to manage your content. When you have the GoPro app for desktop downloaded, when you plug your camera in, it's going to automatically launch the program. It's going to pull up a thing that says, do you want to download all this new footage on your car? This will work for plugging the camera in with USB or via the SD card reader. And it'll ask you, do you want to download this new footage? You can select yes, and you can even set the camera up so that as soon as you plug in that card or camera, it will search for any new content on that card and download it straight onto the computer. Really makes that set of things easy. I know for myself, I often in my years with GoPro have ended up in a situation where I've got an SD card that's full, I've never downloaded any of the content, but I need to use that card again for something else, and I've lost a ton of content doing that. This gives me the ability, as soon as I'm done filming, plug it into the camera, it automatically pulls everything off. Really, really nice, easy workflow. Is capable of also being used with an external hard drive, so if you don't want it all getting dumped straight on your computer, you can do it that way. And then, if you're in the GoPro app at desktop and decide, okay, I like these clips, I want to really go into some more detail on the editing side, you can directly through that application launch into GoPro Studio and get into your more detailed editing. So GoPro Studio is the next thing that I want to talk about. Has anyone out there used GoPro Studio before? Okay, a few of you. So GoPro Studio is our free editing software, free download on GoPro.com. And it has a ton of capability, especially when you compare it to the other free options out there, like iMovie, Windows Movie Maker. The key benefit when we talk about GoPro Studio is that this is a system that's fully optimized around working with GoPro footage. So as I mentioned before, the time-lapse workflow, and you want to create one of those time-lapse videos that we talked about, with GoPro Studio, it is hands down the easiest workflow of any option you have out there. All you have to do with GoPro Studio to create a time-lapse video is import a single photo, just one photo that was taken as part of a time-lapse sequence. The camera will recognize, based on the file naming convention, that it was taken as a part of a sequence, and will automatically stitch that entire sequence into a video for you. So, really, really easy way to get those awesome results. Some other highlights with GoPro Studio. We have edit templates. So for those that maybe don't have any experience with editing, wanting to kind of dip their toe and get a little bit more used to it, you can actually pre-populate your edit timeline with an already released GoPro video that will then allow you to just drag and drop and replace all the original GoPro footage with your own footage. Gives you the ability to use the same music, the same transitions, the same video effects that the original file had. It's a ton of capability. You also have the ability to go in and do color corrections, add audio, add music or voiceovers. You get two audio tracks, you also get two title tracks. You can add tons of stuff to your video and really give it that extra flavor. So let's jump over to some of the mobile editing options. That kind of wraps us up on our desktop software options. Now on the mobile side. So the first one we want to talk about is the GoPro app for mobile. Is anyone out there not using the GoPro app? Okay, anyone put their hand up? I recommend you download it we can take a look at that. Either I'll snag you after we finish up here, or else the GoPro truck activation. We have our tech support team here. We have a whole help desk set up, so we can definitely get you there. Okay, so the GoPro app for mobile is really in a lot of ways similar to the desktop app. It allows you from your phone to go in and access all that content that you shot. The key difference here is that the GoPro app for mobile will also provide you full remote operation of your actual camera. So it makes it really easy to go in and set up your camera, start and stop your recordings, tag those highlights, all that kind of good stuff available within. We mentioned already that trim and share functionality through the app. And the trim and share functionality that I mentioned gets even more important when we talk about the next two apps that I mentioned. You can go in, select your video that you've already shot, pull those smaller sections out of it, and then when you're looking to edit that footage, you can drop it straight into one of these other two options, which are first splice, and then the other one is quick. So splice and first, disclaimer that won't grow up in Splice is that as of today, it is iOS only. We acquired Splice back in February, and we are in development on the Android side of things, so it will be available shortly. But as of right now, it is iOS only. But Splice is essentially giving you all the tools of that desktop editor in the palm of your hand. So really, really incredibly easy. I've got a quick video here to play that kind of outlines Splice and what you can do with it.
Introducing Splice, the simplest way to transform your GoPro or iPhone footage into fully customized professional-looking videos in just minutes. Imagine the performance of a professional desktop editor optimized for your phone or tablet and made easier than ever. So no matter what your skill level, you can edit like a pro with simple yet powerful tools. Just choose your favorite moments and start customizing your video. You can pick your transition style, trim clips, add filters, show off an epic shot in slow-mo, and more. Splice works great with photos too. Add a few to your video and bring them to life with documentary style effects. Then tie it all together with customizable text overlays and title slides. Not only will your video look amazing, it'll sound amazing too. Splice offers a huge variety of free soundtracks, or you can use the song from your iTunes library. Trim and mix multiple tracks and adjust the volume to fine-tune the audio. You can even add fun sound effects or narrate your video with a built-in voice recorder. When your video is just the way you want it, you can post it right to Instagram, Facebook, and more, or share it and save it in gorgeous HD. Splice is available free for your iPhone and iPad. Head to the Apple App Store to download it today. Then create amazing professional-looking videos easier than ever.
Okay, some of the things that I wanted to quickly highlight there and then we'll talk about quick. One is the music side of things. Music has always been, of course, a key part of a lot of the edits, the GoPro edits that you see out there. You mentioned briefly that there is going to be a library of music available. Something that we've been building out over the course of the past few years is building out this music library of pre-licensed music so that anybody's able to take that music that we've made available, add it to their videos, and really, really easily ensure that you're getting great music and also not going to have any issues with the rights to that music. We're currently working to build out a library of over 300,000 tracks that will be available using free license. So that's pretty exciting. And then, of course, you can also use your own music, which is a really key feature there. Now, Quick is our other option, and it is different from Splice in that Quick requires almost no work from you as the actual editor. It is a completely automated system where all you have to do is select the files that you want to pull up. Let's take a look at the video real quick.
Introducing Quick, the fastest and easiest way to create awesome videos from your GoPro or smartphone footage automatically. In just seconds, you can turn your photos and clips into incredible videos perfectly edited to your chosen soundtrack. Quick automatically analyzes your footage to find great moments, adds beautiful transitions and effects, and syncs it all to the beat of the music. text overlays and title slides. You can even add emojis. With a diverse library of great music, you'll find the perfect soundtrack for your video, or use a song of your own. Whatever soundtrack you choose, Quick syncs your video to match the beat and emotion of the music. Just back from a fun weekend getaway or vacation? Every Sunday, Quick surprises you with ready-to-watch videos made from related moments on your mobile device. Just open the app to see what's been created for you. When you're ready to show your friends, just tap save to post your video to Instagram, Facebook, and more, or save it to your mobile device. Quick is available for iOS and Android, now completely free with no in-app purchasing. Download it today, and in just seconds, create an awesome video you'll want to share with everyone. Editing has never been this fast or this fun.
Okay, so you guys can see a theme with our software options that we're really, really working to create more of a streamlined mobile experience for users out there. We certainly don't want to forget about the desktop side of things, but as you know, as GoPro has evolved as a company, we've determined that most people that are shooting with their GoPro are pretty regularly on the go and need that ability to create those edits and share them out without actually having to be tethered to a computer. So I'm not sure if I got anyone's attention with that. Have any of you guys out there signed up for the GoPro giveaway at the booth that's been going on? So we have a really cool opportunity for you guys here today that is just for the people that came out to the classes. We're going to be doing our own little mini giveaway. The way it's going to work is, here is the website. You're going to go to, and I'll leave this up for a minute, but it's GoProTrainingEAA.splashdat.com. I'll leave that so you guys can take it down. You're going to go there. You're going to just fill out a quick, you know, it's basically name, email, address, and then a couple questions about the class. And you guys are going to be entered for a chance to win. And compared to the giveaway we're doing over at the truck, where we get a few thousand people a day signed up, we've got a fairly small group, so your odds are looking pretty good. The winner for the giveaway is going to be announced at 2:30 today. And I've asked for cell phone numbers, so just include your cell phone number and I'll give you a call to announce the winner. It will also go up on this page, so if you guys want to check back, maybe you think something happened and that you didn't look, we'll post up the winner on the actual page. Okay, I'll leave this up for a second, but I'm actually ready to open it up for questions. Does anyone have any other questions? Yeah.
On the highlight tag, if you don't use the GoPro software later on, does it leave something in the file? Is there something in there you can find that later through a different?
Great question. So he was asking if the highlight tag, if you're not using the GoPro software options, will you have some way to still see that tag? And at this point, it's not.
Okay.
It's something that we have been working on a little bit. We've been working a bit with Adobe and some similar editing systems to see if we can incorporate that, but at this point it's not possible.
Okay.
The thing that I wanted to mention though is if you're not using the GoPro app for desktop yet, that's a really great way to use that in conjunction with whatever other editing system you prefer to use. And that's another spot where you're able to use those tags and drop it into your own system.
That's...
Yeah.
What do you recommend to get better battery life?
To get better battery life. So there's a lot of different things that factor into battery life. Which camera model?
I have three.
The three? So, as much as I hate to say this as my answer, but the newer models have actually improved battery life quite a bit. Another thing that goes into that, I'm not sure how long you've had your three, but just like with any battery, over time, they will eventually start degrading a little bit. You do have the option, if you're looking to run your camera continuously for a long period of time, a battery backpack is a great way. It's just an extension that you can add on the back of your camera, and that's going to give you a huge increase in battery life. Our items like battery backpacks and LCD backpacks that we sell are backwards and forwards compatible, so the current battery backpack that we manufacture will work on a Hero 3 as well. Yeah?
What do you recommend? The shapes, wiggles, the vibration, the software?
So, the question was, what software do I recommend to take out vibrations and shakes and things like that? GoPro Studio is a tool that can do it. They're But some easier options, iMovie, for example, does have an image stabilization feature that you can just click image stabilization on iMovie, so that's a really easy way to do it. Within GoPro Studio, you would really kind of need to go in and crop your shot a little bit so that you're getting rid of the edges. But the most important thing when it comes to not having shaky footage is actually how you mount the camera. So where do you typically use your camera and how do you mount it usually?
Helicopter?
Yeah. You are actually not the first helicopter pilot that I've spoken to this week with that exact same question. Helicopter is obviously one of those things where when you're mounting your camera, if you've got some of the highest vibrations and highest, type of movement and activity like that. You know what, if I can chat with you afterwards a little bit, somebody had given me a recommendation, and I'll have to look it up and see if I can find the name of it, but for essentially a foam material that you can mount to that will help stabilize that a little bit as well. And I'll have to take a look at it though. What is it?
Kayak.
Oh, for mounting on a kayak? How would I recommend it? Yeah. So there's a few different options. What kind of kayak is it?
Fiberglass.
Okay. So the adhesive mounts are something that can be used. We actually make a specific adhesive mount that is primarily designed for surfboards. So really designed to be able to stand up to that kind of high, powerful water movement and things like that. You do need a relatively flat, smooth surface on there to do it. I've seen a ton of custom mounted setups on kayaks, one of the most popular ones being where people will mount sort of a pole off the back, and so you get that kind of over-the-shoulder shot, really incredibly popular. I don't know if you're familiar with Jackson kayaks, but the Jacksons are GoPro athletes. Those kayaks actually all have GoPro mounts built into them, but if you take a look at some of their videos that those guys have created, you'll see a ton of different, really innovative and cool mounting positions for kayak.
Better price if you throw a GoPro in.
Yeah. And you have one? So the question was about adjusting the field of view on a shot. First you need to ensure that it is a resolution mode that supports that. So 1080p is the best easy example that does support it. And then you just look for, it depends, there's a few different ways you can do it. You can go into the setup menu on the camera, if you press the side button when you're in your video mode, you'll see field of view as an option, and you just select that and change it. On a silver edition, you can actually double-click the back of the touchscreen in one of those modes that's supported, and that will change it as well. That's kind of a cool shortcut. Or you can do it through the app.
And if you have an older version, is that the Hero?
The Hero? So the Hero... Actually, I do believe the Hero does have it available. Do you have the original HD Hero from 6 years ago, or do you have the Hero that we were selling last year? Because we had two different ones over the years.
It's just for the Hero, it's not the Hero Plus.
Okay, so yeah, the Hero should have that capability. You need to, with that one, because you can't connect to the app or use the screen, you need to do it through the actual setup menu. But just look for the option that says Field of View, and make sure you're in 1080p. Any other questions? Yeah?
I've got a Hero
3
Black.
Okay.
I'm using Windows 10, and I want to burn it. Video to DVD.
Okay.
I've been trying to do that ever since I got the camera, and I just can't seem to make that happen. Can you give me some recommendations?
Yeah, so in order to get it burned to a DVD, now the first thing I do want to mention is that putting it onto a DVD, you will see a reduction in quality because DVD doesn't support the HD broadcast or the HD footage. However, the key to it is how you actually export the video after you edit. There's for burning onto a DVD, I'm not entirely sure off the top of my head what format you're needing, but I can look it up and you can kind of figure that out. But when you go into export, what are you using to edit?
GoPro
Studio. So when you go into your export, when you click export in GoPro Studio, you get a ton of different options that are available. And the key is going to be making sure those options are set up correctly to mesh well with the DVD. And now, again, I don't off the top of my head know what the exact settings are, but if you want to either stop by the truck later or just wait afterwards, I can kind of look it up on my phone real quick and we can figure it out. Cool. Any other questions? Yeah.
One more. On GoPro Studio, when you're doing the time lapse from the photos, like you mentioned, you just pick one photo. Occasionally, it won't pull all of them in. It'll have to go and like pick the first photo, and it'll make, you know, 340 frames, and then I'll pick the last one. Am I doing something wrong while I'm filming, or?
You know, the one spot where I've really seen that happen is if you end up taking one time. Let's say you had a time lapse set up, you're running your camera for a few hours. And instead of setting it to a 10-second duration or 15 or whatever you have it set to a half second. And you end up with way too many photos. What it'll do in that situation is split them into different folders sometimes. That's where I've seen that happen before. I actually haven't seen it happen if they are all in the same folder.
Okay.
If you do happen to get them split into folders, just take them and combine them together into one.
And that's what I've done, but okay.
My other recommendation would be to, if you have time, to stop by our truck and talk to the tech support guys because they're good on the troubleshooting side.
Okay. Thank you.
All right. Yeah. Yeah, that's a great question. So if anyone didn't hear, she was asking for recommendations for duration for intervals on time-lapse videos. So really there are... Yeah. So really there are a few variables that go into that. The first one is going to be how long is whatever you're trying to capture, how long you can let that time-lapse run. The second is going to be how long do you want to display the actual time-lapse once you've got them all in there and sped up. Typically for me, let's say I'm running the camera just off the camera battery. A lot of times with longer time lapses, I like to connect it to external power to ensure that my battery's not coming out. If I run it the entire battery life of the camera, I usually go with 10 seconds. It's about 2 hours of footage at 10 seconds, and then at the end you'll have, before you speed up your actual time lapse video, you'll have 15 or so seconds worth of video. So it gives you a little bit of capability there. All right, yeah.
So to build off that, when you see these night shots of sky.
Yeah.
Are those typically 10 second intervals?
Great question. Probably not, because most of the time I'd say when you're seeing that night shot, you are dealing with the camera that's connected to external power and a longer duration time lapse. For myself, I've run some time lapses when I connect my camera to a power pack, that will run for 10 hours. And if I'm running a 10-hour time lapse, I'll have to go with a longer duration, 20, 30 seconds, options like that. Typically, you don't want to end up with multiple files on your card of photos. If they're all in that same file, you know you're hitting a pretty good spot. All right, guys. Well, thank you so much for coming. I'm gonna hang around a little bit as I kind of get packed up. So if any of you guys did want to chat further, had additional questions, feel free to snag me.
Thank you.
Thank you.